Danke.
So, first of all, I thank you and the organizers very much for giving me the opportunity to be with you today. And this is a wonderful place and conference. And
you might want to use the microphone.
Oh, yes.
Make sure it's on.
I apologize.
He put the microphone in the wrong class.
I apologize. Now you can hear me. Okay, well. Let's start again. So thank you very much for the opportunity of presenting, being here to present our results. Today I will dedicate some time to illustrate our advances in developing an atomic code for time-resolved ionization, and it is fully ab initio. First of all, a short motivation. We are interested in describing the dynamics of electrons in the ionization continuum, possibly in the presence of auto-ionizing states, as it is exemplified in this traditional experiment for the resonant ionization of helium near the auto-ionizing states that are normally visible in photoelectron spectra as a symmetric line shape. What is not known in this kind of experiment is how the decay dynamics of auto-ionizing states unfolds in time. And to figure that out, instead, one has to use ultra-short pulses, as they are available with attosecond technology. In short, strong pulses can lead to the production of sub-cycle pulses of radiation in the extreme ultraviolet, and when used in conjunction with the replica of the fundamental IR pulses, they can be used to do pump probe spectroscopy that allow to coherently excite a wide range of electronic states in the ionization continuum of atoms and figure out how the photoemission dynamics unfold. And to make sense of the experiments that results from this technology, you do need assistance from theory, because otherwise the results are not easily interpreted. So we did so quite successfully in the case of the single ionization of helium, implementing a closed coupling scheme with where you attach to a number of parent ions for the atom, arbitrary states for the electron that would be leaving. You propagate the photoelectron state and, under the influence of the external fields, essentially exactly by solving numerically the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. And at the very end of the pulses, you project everything on a complete set of scattering states to get to the photoelectron angular distributions, for example, or you look at the dipolar response of the atom and you can compute the transit absorption response of the system. And both of these quantities are immediately comparable to experiment. So as an example, in the case of helium, this is the shake-up probability in a single attosecond pump probe experiment in the 2S and the 2P channel as a function of the time delay. And you see all sorts of interference fringes that essentially encode the dynamics of the auto-ionizing states that converge to S and the 2P threshold. And indeed, if you Fourier transform these spectra, resolved in channel, you can reconstruct the composition of the auto-ionizing wave packet that leads to these interferences and also their relative phase, and therefore you can in principle reconstruct the auto-ionizing wave packet itself. So signature of these have been seen in experiment. In this case, it was a measurement done in 2010 of the residual population in the non-shake-up channel in helium, where you see a drop in the population near the lowest auto-ionizing states with a lot of beating as the population recovers as the time delay increases, and we could reproduce a similar structure in the shake-up probability with explicit time-dependent simulations, which are essentially fully converged in this case. Now you can also look at processes with multiple pulses, not just a single pulse. So a common technique is RABBIT, where you use a train of attosecond pulses in association with an IR. In this case, you activate all sorts of two-photon path for the ionization, for example, absorption from one harmonic, and then absorption of an IR, or absorption from the next harmonic, the mixture of an IR, this path interfere, they give rise to a beating. As a function of the pump probe delay, this beating incorporates a phase shift that tells you about the phase difference between consecutive harmonics, but also about the phase difference between two-photon transition matrix elements that in turn tell you something about the group delay in the photoemission, possibly the resonant photoemission. So we used our code to simulate ab initio the RABBIT ionization of helium. At the time, we couldn't do very long pulses, so we essentially used the outcome of the TDSE to calibrate resonant to time-resolved two-photon model that happened to be extremely accurate and which reproduced almost exactly the prediction of the TDSE. So this is a scan in IR energy and photon energy at a specific time delay, and you see that the model and the ab initio calculation are essentially coincident, and then we could reproduce a real experiment with very long IR pulses and eventually reconstruct the amplitude and phase of the resonant transition within a single sideband, and we were able to reconstruct the formation of a Fano profile in the continuum as a function of time from the instant of the excitation. When we tried to look at processes near close to threshold, then it was obvious that model calculation couldn't be possibly used. We did need ab initio simulations, and this is an example where we could compute and compare with measurement the angularly resolved two-photon photoemission delay. And here the model could not possibly work. We also tried to use at the time, in absence of an ab initio code, the model to simulate what would happen in the ionization, resonant ionization of the argon atom. And here we did find, by tuning some parameters that we couldn't possibly estimate, a decent agreement with the experiment, and we were reasonably happy with that. We estimated the possible error that the model entailed, but we got the right-ish answer for the right-ish reason. And when we tried to resolve angularly the photoelectron spectrum, there is no way that a model could give decent results. And that is how we decided to bite the bullet and to develop really the polyelectronic version of the helium ab initio code. So as you have seen several times, we use a time-dependent closed coupling approach. So we expand the wave function for the system in terms of symmetry-adapted wave functions. Each symmetry-adapted wave function has an expansion of some pseudo-channel localized states, plus an expansion on closed coupling ionization channels. This closed coupling channel has a parent ion coupled to the angular spin part of the photoelectron and a radial part where the photoelectron is described hopefully almost exactly with a B-spline or a FDVR basis. In our case, we use B-splines. And the parent ions are treated at the level of multi-configurational trifoc using the ATSP2K called by Charlotte Fraser-Fisher. So as an illustration of how this thing works, I have devised a study case, which is the ionization of neon, a significantly more complex system than helium, and near an intruder state. So you have the 2p hole starting here and stays in the continuum, then the 2s hole opens up, and above that there is eventually a threshold for the doublet p even state that gives rise to a whole set of autoionizing states. These states are not really that polarly coupled to the ground, so they would normally be invisible, except that there is the lowest term of a series that converges to a much higher threshold, the doublet even, a threshold that falls in between, that is coupled to the ground, that gives oscillator strength to these doublet attestates, and these are eventually visible in the experimental spectrum. So the interesting dynamics here is that you populate this door state. This door states decays to the autoionizing states, and these autoionizing states eventually decay to the continuum. So this kind of thing is really not easily describable with simple models. So this is how to illustrate from the point of view of the users how we can do this calculation, and I want to stress that it was important for me to make an effort to develop, to wrap up the code and to develop it in such a way that undergraduate and graduate students could use it without becoming crazy, without making at least one error each time they tried to run it. So first you want to build the configuration state function for the neutral and the ion in a way that is consistent, that you don't double count stuff, that you add all the configurations that must be added, and you don't treat correlation in a different way whether of the ion in a different way whether the electron is far or whether it is close. So the only thing that you have to define is a set of reference configuration for the ions, some constraint for the restricted CI, some constraint for the principal quantum numbers, maximum orbital angular momentum for the localized electron, for the wave electron, the number of excitation, and then the symmetries of all the ions that you want, the symmetries of all the augmented neutral that you want. And once you've done that, it is easy to think how to build this structure. Everything is automatically determined. And it is not for the user to complete consistently all the additional steps. Then we have to define the basis, the radial basis for the electron. It is a B-spline basis that has already been illustrated to you in a couple of occasions. It is very flexible. It is perhaps not the best because it gives rise to sparse but still bounded matrices. It is piecewise polynomials. That is, then the user doesn't have to decide much here. And then the program must build the close coupling space in the CFSF basis. That is, for each and every configuration of the ion, you attach an electron and you build the whole space that results. This is, for each symmetry, a pretty ginormous state space, 10 to the 5, typically CSF. The generation of it, however, is completely automatic, and the students just run common line directives, and they get it done. It is too big, however, this space to really do the TDSC on top of it, so we have to define an effective closed coupling space where you recouple all the ions so that they are correlated. So you just define for each symmetry the number of channels that you want as the multi-reference Hartree-Fock states. You can specify the strength of the complex absorber for the simulation. You can specify even a shift in the global channel if you want to fine-tune the relative position of the resonances, if that is necessary. And then with a couple of commands, you do build the final closed coupling space. Then you need to solve the spectral problem in each symmetry. I don't go over the details. Let's just say that with this closed coupling B-spline approach, computing bound states, exterior complex scaling states, or even scattering states that obey prescribed the boundary condition is almost trivial. It is very robust, and in fact, it takes more time to write on disk the scattering states than it takes to compute them. It is pretty easy for the students to compute all these the spectral resolution. They just have this common line, they specify the symmetry, the kind of calculation that they want, and they get thousands of states that they will need in the simulation. And again, with a single common line, they can compute photoelectron photoionization spectra, perturbative ones. So this is a comparison in the case of neon. This is the experimental spectrum, this is the series converging to the 2S-1 threshold. Here I am indicating the calculation in the minimal basis that we have seen before in the length and velocity gauge. I shifted down the velocity, the length by this quantity here. So this gives you a measure of the at least the gauge error that we have. But apart for this background, the agreement is already pretty good, and we do see the crest of states that are that receive the oscillator strength from the intruder. In principle, we can also go beyond the one-photon dipole, where we have implemented also the two-photon reduced dipole matrix elements with some regularization for the intermediate for the intermediate Green function. So you can loop, you can have one photon and then G0 plus another photon and the final state in the continuum. The summation in the intermediate states is done over all the channel, over all the continua, with some regularization that makes the diagonal part of this matrix element in terms of excitation frequency and final energy inaccurate. So this would need to converge with respect to some parameters. But otherwise, you can see here the excitation of the 2S2P state giving rise to a response in the photoelectron spectra at the 2S square or the 2P square SW excited state. So in principle, from these matrix elements, you can compute pump probe photoelectron spectra time resolved. But let's look now at the real simulation. Let's say that we want to study this resolved in time. So we need, for example, to get to the auto-ionizing states with one XUV and say one harmonics, and then in this case I look at a more sensitive observable, the following harmonics, meaning that if I add on top of these two harmonics and IR, I can do an interference between a one photon and a two photon transition leading to a photoemission asymmetry near the auto-ionizing states, or far from the auto-ionizing states in a region where there are no many resonances. We need to solve the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. We do that by propagating the wave function with a second-order exponential propagator. Since we can treat exactly and separately the action of H0, we do that. So we split the exponential propagator, and we treat the H0 exactly. We treat iteratively the action of the dipole interaction with a Krylov method. Incidentally, this propagator is implemented in PETSI, so it can run on supercomputers. And then to represent the effect of long pulses in a box that is not too huge, what we do is that for some time we do a numerical propagation, and when the wave packet has expanded enough, we chop off the outer part, and we assume that the outer part will propagate in the field and in the Coulomb potential in a way that the field and the Coulomb part we assume commute, because it is far enough from the origin. So this outer part we can do analytically, and we continue propagating the internal part numerically without ever hitting the absorbing boundary. So we can reconstruct the photoelectron spectrum quite accurately. The students can write the input for the simulation quite easily, so they define the pulses. They define the input file for the simulation, where to find the pulses, where to start, when to end, which is the initial state, and then they run the simulation, specifying whether they want to do it in velocity or in length gauge. I don't go over the detail where this splitting approach is accurate. And this is what you can get. You can project on the scattering states the wave packet at the end, and you get an infinite resolution photoelectron spectra. So the peak for the for the transition in the P symmetry, it is the light blue near the resonances and above the doublet P even threshold. And in purple, you see the singlet S even amplitude due to the two photon transition. The interferences of these two amplitudes would give rise to an asymmetry in the beating. If you look at the phase of those amplitudes, you see that there is a modulation in the phase giving rise to a resonant group delay near the auto-ionizing states. In the upper sideband, instead, you see a much broader modulation that is due to the fact that here we lose the detailed information of the decay of the individual resonant states, and we really see the effect of the decay of the intruder. So the width of the this phase excursion really tells you how fast the intruder decays into the auto-ionizing series. And observables are probably more like the following. Instead of looking directly at the phase of the amplitude, we can compute the photoelectron angular distribution, in this case represented in terms of a symmetry parameter. So beta 0 is time delay independent, beta 1 and beta 3 instead do show omega beating, as expected. You can see a time delay between the photoemission along one direction and other direction. So this is experimentally unconfirmed, but this is the kind of potential of calculation that this code can do. And in the case of the ionization to the doublet P event channel, you see a beautiful modulation of the sideband beating due to the intruder decay. And then we could try to validate the code for traditional rabbit ionization of argon in collaboration with calculation with measurement done in the group by Ludi Mauro. So they have measured something similar to what was measured in the past in the group of Lund. So this is the set of delay by changing the energy of the IR. And these colored dots is the prediction of our simulation. And while we did also transit absorption, we can do that with the model. And let's say that we have the first confirmation of the consistency of our TDSC calculation, again in argon. Here you have the photoelectron spectrum. On top of it, in the case of one photon transition, also the transit absorption. They should coincide. They do coincide, so at least in that it is consistent. And when we compare the variation of the transit absorption spectrum with respect to the field free transit absorption with experimental measurement from the group of Arvinder Sandhu, now we finally get a first ab initio prediction that is kind of in line with the experiment, so we are happy with that. And they conclude saying that all this effort essentially has already replicated everything that we can do with helium, but in arbitrary atoms to a level that my undergraduate or graduate students can use it, even if they don't understand all the details. And in general, in my work in the past, in the work with Fernando, or in this work, the general idea is that we are trying to compute matrix elements, one particle or two particle, between close coupling states, and we are trying to go around the problem of figuring out how to get essentially one body or two body or even three body transition density matrices between parent ion states. If we were able to do that systematically, then it doesn't matter whether the method is X-CAM or Armin's method or my method. This is these transition density matrices between arbitrary parent ion states would allow us to build the close coupling matrix elements that we need to do single ionization or even double ionizations of atoms and molecules. And this is an effort that I am doing now with Barry and Jeppe. And well, these are the conclusions, but I thank you very much for your patience and attention.